Hello, I'm Ann Deverson. Before you settle back too comfortably, go and switch on your FM radio, because tonight we're in for a fantastic treat. It's a simulcast of Elton John's Tour de Force of Australia at the end of last year, when his rock band joined forces with Melbourne Symphony Orchestra, and together they exploded a heap of stuffy ideas. Years ago, I interviewed Duke Ellington, and I asked him how he described his music. He said, "It's music. If it's good, we play it. If it's bad, we tear it up." And music was the common denominator that brought together classical and rock, set alight with Elton's brilliance. This program takes us behind the scenes of the tour, and it's good to watch the camaraderie and respect that grows between the two groups of musicians. It's an ABC documentary, and it looks good and sounds terrific.
About a year ago, Elton first muted to me a notion that he would love to take an orchestra out on the road with him, which I thought was a wonderful idea and something that I, many years ago, had been part of with him at the Festival Hall, or way back in the early 70s. And it was something that I tried to encourage him to do again.
And I honestly think that if it comes off as I think it will be, it will probably be one of the most incredible, spectacular events, sound-wise, as well as to look at. But I mean, sound-wise, the reason I am doing it egotistically-wise is I think the only person to do this sort of concert and pull it off.
And you'll see a marriage between rock and classical which has never been seen before. It's really unprecedented. It's a world first.
Melbourne Symphony Orchestra, a showpiece of the Australian Broadcasting Corporation doing what it knows best. But the ABC had high hopes for its 88 symphony players. It wanted to send them on a musical mystery tour, to take them out of this normally subdued classical environment and toss them full force into this. Hardly a marriage made in heaven, but a marriage it was to be. Classical musicians in the world of rock and roll. After 16 years of successful touring, Elton John was ready to take that gamble. The end of his 1986 world tour would bring him to Australia and what he'd call his tour de force, a six-week sweep of the country down under, with a 13-piece band, an 88-piece orchestra, and a production exercise the scale of a military operation.
Well, I think there's plenty of surprises in store for us, because I think, very positive on how it's going to be, I think with the two fusions of music from their point of view and our point of view, I think, I have a feeling we're going to get on very, very well, and that we're both going to, I hope both factors get a lot of enjoyment out of it. I think we will. I have a great feeling it's going to be something tremendous. It will either be tremendous, it can only go two ways, it'll either be tremendous or real, why did he bother? There's no in between on this one.
So much of Elton John's music had already been recorded with orchestral arrangements, but it had never been scored for a full orchestra. That was now the job of this man, James Newton Howard, a former keyboard player with Elton's band. His background was classical, but his image, rock and roll.
When I think of myself as a musician, not as a rock and roll musician, or classical musician. I would say when the idea was first presented to the orchestra that they had probably a clear picture of me as Ozzy Osbourne or something worse, of a wild-eyed, drug-crazed lunatic who was going to come over and present them with endless whole notes and something really boring to do.
James Newton Howard. I shit myself when I heard he was going to conduct the orchestra, but he turned out to be a diamond. He was a lunatic in the mid-70s, but he's a superb musician.
What James Newton Howard spent 5 months creating on paper finally becomes music to his ears when he meets face-to-face with the orchestra in Melbourne. But James is a conductor with limited experience, working with players used to the best.
I'm still not happy with the way this is going here, and I'm not sure what I want to help you, believe me. I want to do it as best as I can, and I'm not sure how to do it any better. Does it appear that I'm still dragging?
Yeah.
I am.
Can I say something?
No? Yes?
Well, you're accustomed to a studio or rock and roll situation where you're going to have to... Just you keep going, and we'll come with you.
All right.
And that sometimes you're going to feel as though you're a whole lot ahead. But the more you go ahead, the more we will come with you.
All right.
We're quite accustomed to reading.
Okay, one more time. I won't wait.
At the end of the day, orchestra and conductor find a common level. But opinions about the merit of the tour remain mixed. Some orchestra members have refused to go. Others join in reluctantly.
I think it's wrong. We should not be playing in this type of medium. But I was, thought it would be good. Did most of the orchestra were in favour, and I went along with it. And I thought, well, I'll be tacit and I won't say anything and go along for the holiday and have all the free time that we have.
Had you heard of Elton John? Did you know his music at that stage?
No, not one. I hadn't heard. My children had.
Just 4 days before the first concert in Brisbane, Elton and his orchestra are yet to meet musically. He uses the quiet morning hours to acquaint himself with the vast stage and to reacquaint himself with the music he'd so carefully crafted years before. On this tour, Elton would return to the compositions that had launched him back in the early 70s.
the orchestra arrives for the first full rehearsal, there are no ceremonial introductions. If there's to be a rapport between the singer and his new band, it will grow naturally.
Orchestra was one of great excitement because the setting that they were put into, the orchestral set that we have, it's like a shell, is rather terrific. It's been brilliantly designed and there were really very few problems with it, so there weren't any problems in that direction, so we were looking at musical things. Elton came and sat down on the podium and sang very quietly. He was a little bit worried about singing in front of us, I think, a little bit embarrassed in front of everybody. But after he'd sung a couple of numbers, we gave him quite a lot of accolade, which he enjoyed. And then he started to sit down at the piano and we started to do some of the numbers where he plays with the piano. From then it just grew.
You know the war you fought wasn't too much fun. The future you're giving me holds nothing for gone. I know it's to be living.
So quickly, and it was astonishing, and the goodwill and the good feel. I mean, there was enough electricity here yesterday and the hall was empty to light up Brisbane, and you could feel it. I mean, it was quite extraordinary. And that is, if you're a musician, that is the point of being a musician, is the fact that that's what you get from your music. You come away and the adrenaline is just superb. I wasn't nervous, actually. I wasn't nervous playing. I was quite pleased with why I played. I kept time okay. Made a couple of goofs and a couple of numbers. But that's because I was so enthralled with listening to the orchestra that I wasn't concentrating on what I was doing.
Technical headaches are easing. Gus Dudgeon, Elton's record producer, is mixing the 88 orchestral players. Then that sound, along with Elton and his band, is balanced by Clive Franks, a sound engineer who's been with Elton throughout his career.
When I first heard about it, I went into total panic. And I'm mixing about 70 channels of sound before I even think about it. So that's just the band with the 13 guys on stage, plus effects and everything. So obviously Gus coming in, he was brought in to solely concentrate on the orchestra.
Hi, Roz.
Good morning.
Excellent.
This sounds wonderful. I've
got tears in my eyes
already.
Encouraged by the morning's rehearsal, the orchestra takes a break.
Looks good. It is good.
But the big test is ahead. Elton's rock and roll band is yet to be heard.
Oh, yeah. Give me a break.
Lead guitarist Davey Johnson is impressed. After a long partnership with Elton, this will be his greatest challenge. Percussionist Ray Cooper's last tour with Elton saw just the two of them alone on stage. This would indeed be something different. And these musicians are used to hearing their music at just one level, loud.
Thank you.
For principal clarinet player Philip Michel, it's all a bit much.
I feel that the noise level is far too loud, and I think it's a dangerous thing in our society. I think the words have got a lot of message, and I think that's one has to admit that. Yes, and I think he's got melodic interest in the tunes, yes. I can see. Yeah, I agree to that. But I don't, once the band starts, I do not like the amplification, and I don't like the orchestra having to be amplified the way it is, and I just don't think the medium, the orchestra is suitable to this medium.
I'm having a bit of trouble here.
What we've got to do now is keep our volume down, keep disciplined, so that we can hear them, because that's the whole point. We don't want to play so loudly that we can't hear them. Otherwise, you know, actually, I had to ask them to turn the strings down, which was great. But it's the whole point now is just keeping our volume down for our set, being even more aware as musicians about the highs and lows of our own songs, which is good, because you go back on your own songs and you tend sometimes in our business to keep playing them. There's not enough highs and lows. So this time, you're watching James all the time, you're watching Davey, I'm watching Davey all the time, watching Charlie, to keep those highs and lows in. It's very important. It's tremendously good discipline and great fun.
He wants to do it one more time. They're going to tape it.
So another compromise is made. The band turns it down, and even the remaining minor problems are tackled with good humour.
I think it's a much better idea. Drop the whole thing.
All right, James? We're really happy. I feel a bit badly that Raymond is relegated to the...
Not at all. It's a pleasure.
Check in.
Musicians and you were rock and rollers?
Yeah,
it can affect you, yeah.
Well, Alan said yesterday, you feel superfluous to a certain extent. You know, when you hear all this beautiful stuff happening, you feel like, you know, Christ.
Really, I think we've all been a bit on edge with it. As you say, they're all classically trained musicians. But we're carrying our job up quite...
Some of us have had some training.
Competent.
Well, maybe I have.
Yeah, I've got 3 days.
Maybe you have.
I can play the happy kangaroo.
No, I started off playing viola. That was my first instrument. I started off... So I was classically trained up to the age of about 13 or something, until I went mental.
I'd like to learn classical progression, actually. I would love to play in an orchestra. To me, it just covers everything. So, yeah, I'd like to do that.
It's very different.
After a couple of days rehearsing together, the two groups start to unwind. They're searching for common ground, and a few drinks help.
I knew you were a flute player. Yeah. This is Charlie Martin.
Because I've seen you up at this time.
Reading about Bach and how he used to improvise and dazzle everyone with his expertise in piano or cello or whatever.
And you are playing on the piano or something?
Mandolin, banjo, sitar, lots of all the strings.
And you sing as well?
All the stuff.
Elton is lucky to have such a crew.
He is lucky.
He is lucky.
He is too. Very lucky.
Yes.
He's also very lucky to have all that money.
And also. Oh, well, that's part of his business, you know. But this musical arranger, the conductor, he's very good.
It's wonderful, isn't it?
He's very good.
James Newton Howard, say no more.
He's very good.
He's brilliant.
By opening night, there's an air of expectation. Sneak press previews have alerted the 12,000 fans who roll in to expect something new. Backstage, the mood is united, and Elton is clearly moved by the easy camaraderie that's developed.
I just want to say thanks very much for the rehearsals and everything. It's just, it's an honour to be playing with you. Your attitude, everything's great. This is for everyone. They're all handwritten by me. It took me ages. You can write.
Bob Red Buffer. Let this occasion go.
I'm not an occasion.
You are now. I'm unaccustomed as I am. On this, the Elton and Robert John tour.
Where was Olivia when we needed her?
Seriously now, just for a split second, that was it, that was the serious moment. I would like to say that really we are enjoying this very much. It's a great experience.
Here's to tonight and a great concert. Yeah. Thank you.
It's going to blow their mind. It really is. They've played to large numbers before. Back in Melbourne, at the Meyerbell concerts, they played to 15, 20,000 people. But they're a silent audience. You're going to get a very vocal audience. You're going to get 20,000 people who are going to be there with them all the way. I think it's going to be an incredible experience for all the musicians concerned.
Prepare now.
Thank you.
its appearance only in the second half of the show.
Thank you. Standing by.
Now the marriage is to face its acid test. Elton appears after interval as colourful as ever, a latter-day Amadeus.
Thank you very much. In this half of this show, we're going to attempt some numbers that haven't really been done before with full orchestra. Some of them are from way, way back, from the Elton John album, which was the first album with orchestra on it. And the first arrangements that you hear from the Elton John album are by Paul Buckmaster, and James has sort of tarted them up a bit because they were only made for a 20-piece orchestra. This next song is called I Need You to Turn To.
Exactly the right chord. No one has expected it to come together so poignantly and so triumphantly.
Everyone went home, I'm sure, exhausted, and went to, I mean, I listened to the tape back and was just quite extraordinary. I keep saying it, the attitude of the people involved is quite magnificent, so far.
The Tour de Force will play 27 dates throughout 5 states of Australia. Logistically, it's a massive exercise for the promoters. Almost 300 people and countless tons of equipment have to be transported and accommodated. But as they roll out of Brisbane and on to Melbourne, there's an expectation of even better things to come.
Extended basis, because this most certainly has to be the most commercial thing we've done. I think to be so totally involved for 6 or 7 weeks of our life in a rock and roll era, this is certainly a first for me.
Back in their hometown, members of the MSO take a rest from the hotel rooms. It's time for some normality and some reflection on the last hectic week.
Some people would have had some reservations about doing a tour such as this, but I think Elton's sheer musical energy has overcome anyone's reservations, really. And I think noticing what's happening over this past couple of weeks is that the MSO is sort of freeing up, and you look around and there are people really, you know, jiving in their chairs, and that's good. I wonder how our regular audience, though, would take it, because for many of them, you know, a Beethoven symphony is a visit to a shrine. And if you don't play Bach seriously, well, I mean...
It brings the orchestra, all the orchestras, to a much wider public, a non-concert-going public. For example, this tour will bring the name Melbourne Symphony Orchestra into the homes of millions of people. And at a year hence, or 6 months hence, we may find people saying in the street, the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra, yes. Aren't you the band who played with Elton John? And I think that's very, very important.
What do you give a benefactor who has everything? A problem the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra confronts mid-tour. Elton John has provided them a new status in Australia and is repaid with the first ever honorary life membership of the MSO.
Many, many thanks, Elton, for all you've done. We appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Bring it down. All right.
Thank you very much. I'm stumped for words, is it, really? this is a wonderful honour. That
no need for consolidation between me and the orchestra. It's already there. But this is just confirmation of what a wonderful time we're all having together, and it's a great honor for me. I've made a lot of friends. I dread the end of this tour, but I know it's had a lot of publicity. I'm very overwhelmed by this. It's quite extraordinary. Thank you. And I would just hope that my ties with the orchestra can help the orchestra in the future, as we may have done at the moment, by selling the orchestra to a market which really has never been sold to before. And it's very important that when I leave the country, that the people who are in charge of the orchestra make sure that the young people who come to the shows and have never seen an orchestra before go to the symphony concerts as well, because that's really important. I've never had such a love away with someone over there, but I'm actually going to bed with anybody. thank you. This is wonderful. Thanks very much.
Well, it tends to be, I mean, music can become, and has become in many ways, which is I find a great tragedy, it's become very isolated. So there becomes this kind of suspicion now of classical jazz, rock music, where the underlying common denominator is that we all make music, which is the most stunning form of communication.
We're all trying to be, as 88 players, trying to play together, and you as 13 or something, are all trying to play together in tune, and with some semblance of balance and sensitivity. I mean, we're all really trying to achieve the same, same end. The language is slightly different, that's right.
So I can have a shot with the banjo, and I was well over, I was on Guinness and stuff, and we'd all end the tour again. And the guy kind of went, well, okay, you know, he thought, oh, rock and roll musician, you know, long hair and all. And I went up there and got, it was like I went back 8 years, you know, remembered everything, remembered all the stuff, and I thought, great.
Yeah.
Just got lost, and they were rather stunned, you know, just to see an old hippie playing.
By now, there's no doubt that the marriage of the two musical forms is a happy one. Even Elton, who's known to be reclusive and sometimes moody on tour, is treating this trip like a holiday. His staff have never seen him so carefree.
And my lip is smudged because I've had a cup of coffee. Look, cup of coffee. Good God, I used to be so butch. Don't laugh. You swines. And I've changed my mind. I was going to wear my star outfit, but I'm going to let them have it with the devil outfit tonight, but without the feathers. Because when you got that on, you I can't move from side to side. Plus the back, it gets caught in the back.
Yeah, with that hair.
Yeah. It's the closest you've been to a man for a few weeks. He said generously. Make the most of it, girl. Okay. Do it smudge down here.
Yeah, I know.
I've got it on my finger and all. You dark bitch. Right. Cozzy. Stop! Are they Big V?
Hey, Nick?
Are they filming Big V? Good God.
They're filming the artist at work.
Oh.
If you ever go, Davey, I want your skin for luggage.
My skin for luggage. Is that a country and western song?
You can have my skin for luggage. All the tears they wash their words out of you.
From the blackboard of my heart.
I don't know how you can sit out in the sun and... Can it drain me or something? I'm just sitting out there for an hour. Oh, I get energized, though. I know you do. Then you go down the pub. I don't know how you do it. Constitution of a suitcase.
Well, I think I'll just go and drop a couple of luggage.
Yeah. Hold me closer, tiny hold all.
David, you've known Elton a long time. Do you think you really know him?
No. Definitely not. I mean, there's so many sides to the guy. I know certain things about him, yeah. A lot of dish, too. But, no, I don't know him properly yet.
Why not?
He's a very quiet guy, very shy, you know. I mean, I don't know, it's strange. I can't really describe it. He's a very weird, quiet geezer who likes his privacy, you know, and we all respect that. And he loves occasionally to have a laugh, as you know, as you've seen. No, I just respect the fact that he likes to let that bit of privacy, you know, and he should have it. He worked hard enough for it.
I don't know at all. And now I know him as well as anybody.
I know him through the music. I mean, that's very, very strange. That's all I want to know about him. I know the passion and the gentleness and the pathos of him through the music. And there are many layers that obviously, as a wonderful showman, roll off the stage into real life. So there are very many facade areas. I think I have an understanding of where the layers start and finish. And sometimes in between the robing and the disrobing, you get a sight of the real man. And he's a very nice man too. But he does tend to, I think, after many years of performing, there are many, many layers. And I think some people don't know how to disrobe, or they get affected. They think they know a certain area, and then he puts on another robe. And I think there's a kind of a knowledge, there's a passive knowledge or that he has now about what he is and who he is, and an acceptance, and an ability to live within himself, with himself, rather.
No man's a jazz down playing Shakespeare round your throne room floor, while the juggler's act is danced upon the crown.
It's almost too good to be true that the tour can continue without a hitch, and it doesn't. Elton has been plagued with a throat problem that eventually overcomes him in Perth. Later, he'd require surgery to correct it, but for one night, he's unable to perform. On a tour such as this, both the artist and his fans are bitterly disappointed.
I mean, it was very, you know, in that situation, you just have to stand at the end of the firing line and take all the flak that comes at you.
It's the first time, I believe, you've ever really lost a show, not been able.
Yeah, absolutely. Once in 16 years. Well, once in more than that, once in about 18 years.
I
would have to be on a tour like this.
Well, at least now you're in Sydney. Yeah. Is this sort of the downhill run? I mean, is this what you've been waiting for?
Not particularly. It's not a downhill run. Which is more shows concentrated into this space of time. But the lights at the end of the tunnel, in fact, I don't really want the tunnel to end. But there's going to be a lot of very sad people. I'm going to be very sad when this tour ends.
Already depressed about his voice, the singer cops another body blow in Sydney. The first critic to damn the show dismisses the efforts of Elton and the orchestra and attacks his outrageous costumes and staging.
Wow, this guy really doesn't like it,
didn't I, Alan? Clive got. Was this the one that from here?
Yeah. On stage that night, the normally flamboyant star responds to the criticism sartorially.
Oh, not in this outfit. Some latent Liberace I am tonight, right? One, two, three.
Off stage, temporarily stopping the show. It's the first off-key note in the tour, and confusion reigns.
Right back.
Thank you.
stage, only Elton knows the next move. When he eventually makes it, he forgets to tell his band.
You are quite remarkable. Once again, I really apologize. Let's get on with it, he said. Do you remember this one?
16 years in show business makes Elton John a professional. As the dust settles, he puts in one of his best performances. It seems the drama has all been part of the tension and build-up to closing night. The last show in Sydney is to be telecast live to an audience of millions, and the excitement has been growing throughout the performances. For many of the musicians and road crew, there's also a mounting sense of loss as this unique tour draws to a close.
Because no one really wants it to stop, actually. People, I think, would like... I mean, I suppose, in a way, everybody's looking forward to the last night because we all know it's going to be unbelievable. We all know it's going to be great. And there's like a steady build-up to it. But however, so you look forward to it on that level. However, everybody's going to be thinking, oh, what a shame. Because they've all been saying, what are we going to do in America? It's really odd. We're going to have to go back to being a normal band again, you know.
For 6 weeks, the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra has experienced life on the road through the eyes of a rock and roll band. For many, the return trip to Melbourne will be a jarring touchdown to reality.
I wish it would start again. Really was very good marriage between the orchestra and Elton and his group.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably in a way it's just what's going to end, because it's just been one long party. The whole thing's been terrific. It's really been, I'm going to miss it a lot.
It's changed my attitude to rock musicians. I don't know what I expected, really, but I find them very nice people, you know, they're very just like anybody else. I think the image we get of rock musicians isn't very good, but not a bit like that. They're good musicians, they're just very normal people.
Whatever happens to the orchestra next year, whatever happens to it in the future, this will be probably one of the greatest times, I think, professionally and personally, that I've ever had. Too late.
Signed the back of this, and we give this to you with much appreciation, gratitude, and love.
When I first began the tour, I was a very, very bad conductor, and I hope I've graduated to a very mediocre conductor. I'd be pleased with that.
You people are magic. You've made my life and everybody on this tour so much a part. It's been a wonderful tour. I don't want to get too Woodstock. Hey, man, you've been really fabulous. I just wish I could remember it, you know?
Somewhere along the line, I was a string player I bumped into.
As this extraordinary tour comes to its finale, there's little of the sadness everyone's expected. For all of those involved, closing night is not the end of the road, but the start, they hope, of a new musical era.